In this video, we're going to look at how to use Euler's method to approximate the solution to a system of differential equations. So you may already be familiar with how to use Euler's method to approximate the solution to a single first-order equation. Here, we're going to look at a pair of first-order equations. So in particular, for this whole video, we're going to be focused on the Laplace-Volterra equations. So this is a pair of differential equations used to model the interaction between two species in an ecosystem, one which is the predators and another which is the prey. So here are those equations. We will use capital R for the prey, you can think of those like rabbits, and capital F for the predators, so those will be foxes. So the first equation describes the rate of change of the prey population over time, and the second describes the rate of change of the predators over time. Notice both rates of change depend on the other population, so you cannot separate them. We have four parameters in the system, and I've named them A, B, C, and D. The way this is written with the plus and minus signs, all are non-negative. To understand the parameter A, what we can imagine is that in the absence of foxes, the rabbits grow exponentially. So A is like the natural growth rate of the prey in the absence of predation. Similarly, if there were no rabbits, we would expect the foxes to die off. So C here, together with that negative sign, tells us how quickly the foxes die off if there's no food. And then minus BRF and plus DRF are interaction terms. So that negative B is communicating to us that the rabbits die off due to predation. And the plus DRF is communicating how the foxes grow due to consuming the food. Each of these is a derivative, but we can also think of those right-hand sides as functions of the populations R and F. So for notational convenience, I'm going to say that the function A times R minus B times R times F is a function we'll name G sub 1 of R and F. And likewise, G sub 2 of R and F will be the function negative C times F plus D times R times F. So if I use G1 and G2, I'm talking about these right-hand sides. Euler's method is an algorithm that allows us to approximate the true solution to this pair of differential equations. So what we're about to do is an estimate. The idea is that the true change in the rabbit population from one time to another could be written as the new population is the old population plus how much it changed. So that is literally a measure of how much the rabbits have changed from one moment to the next, where delta R is that change. What we can do is take delta R and multiply it and divide it by delta T, where delta T is how much time is elapsing over the course of this change. Notice I still have equality here because I'm going to multiply and divide by the same term. But now we're going to bring in an estimate. Notice the change in R divided by the change in T is a difference quotient. If I took the limit of this quotient as delta T went to zero, it would give us a derivative. It would give us dr dt. We are not going to let delta time actually go to zero. We're going to have a positive time step. But our estimation process is going to say that if that time step delta t is small enough, then the difference quotient delta r divided by delta t can be approximated by the derivative r prime of t computed at the original populations. Dr dt is something that we have. That's what we're calling the function g1. So let me keep working left to right in the line up above. What we can say is that the new population is approximately the previous population plus G1 measured at the previous populations times the time step. So here I've replaced the difference quotient delta R over delta T with dr dt. Check your understanding to see if you can write down the approximation for the foxes. What you should find is that the new fox population is approximately the old fox population plus G2 measured at the old populations times the time step. I've used subscripts 0 and 1 here to indicate going from an old population to a new population, but we'll just keep building up those subscripts as we keep estimating the change in the populations. So my next approximation could be for R2, F2, and then R3, F3, etc. So now we're ready to state the algorithm. All right, the first thing we need is a jumping off point. So we want to implement this method based on some starting pair R0, F0. Next, I would determine the step size delta t. In practice, you might actually just be told that. You might be told delta t is 0.1. Alternatively, you could be told the final time, the starting time, and the number of iterations, in which case you would say delta t is the ending time minus the beginning time divided by how many steps we took. Or you could be given some variant of this information. But the point is, you should be told enough to create a sequence of time values, the initial time, which is typically 0, t1, t2, all the way through the end of the procedure. Assuming delta t is consistent throughout the estimation, they should be evenly spaced. Then with the equations on hand, what we would do is simultaneously update the populations for each of those time values. So our approximation for the new rabbit population for every time we take a step in this process is based on the previous rabbit population plus g1 of the previous populations times the time step. And similarly, our approximation for the new fox population is the previous fox population plus g2 of the previous populations times the time step. Notice that you have to plug rn, fn into both functions every time you step forwards. So what you can't do is generate all the rabbits, then generate all the foxes. You have to generate rabbits and foxes simultaneously. Okay, let's see how this works. Here we have the Laca-Volterra equations, and I've gone ahead and substituted in values for those parameters. What we want to suppose is that these equations model rabbits and foxes in an ecosystem where time is measured in weeks. If there are currently 40 rabbits and 8 foxes, let's use Euler's method to approximate the populations every day for 60 weeks. Okay, read through this again and identify the initial conditions. What you should have found is that the initial conditions come from the piece of information that tell us that we have 40 rabbits and 8 foxes. So 40 and 8 will be our jumping off values. Next, figure out what delta t is. So what's the time step? That piece of information comes at the very end. We want to approximate the populations every day for 60 weeks. Time is measured in weeks here, so measuring every day is like 1/7 of a unit of time. So you could get to that number immediately. Or if you wanted to set up a ratio, you could say that our ending time is at 60 weeks, our beginning time is 0 weeks, and then the number of iterations is going to be 60 weeks times 7 days per week, so 420 iterations. So that agrees with our earlier figure that delta t is 1/7. All right, we've done the first two steps of the process. Now I just want to highlight in the third step that if we look at the equations for the new populations, according to our algorithm, we're going to compute the new rabbit population by saying it's the old rabbit population plus, and then what I call g1, we're now going to put in that right-hand side for drdt. We evaluate that right-hand side at the old populations. So in this notation, that's r sub n and f sub n. And then in our formula, we had delta t. I've replaced that here with 1/7. And same story for the new foxes. Now, theoretically, we would do this 420 times. That's not something I want to do by hand. So let me take you through the first few computations, and then I'll just show you the final results in MATLAB. Okay, so when time equals 0, we know from our initial conditions that there are 40 rabbits and 8 foxes. Now we apply the method. We go from time equals 0 to time equals 1/7. The unit there is 1/7 of a week. And here's how we get our approximated values for the rabbit and fox populations after a day has gone by. So what we're going to do is take the previous values and insert them into the equations. Looking at this pair of equations, notice that only the 40 and the 8 need to be updated every time we do the iteration. The 0.1, 0.02, 0.03, 0.01, and 1/7, those stay the same. So it's kind of a funny result if you're talking about members of a population, but our estimate says there should be 39.66 rabbits and 8.11 foxes. Okay, before I move on, go ahead and compute the next time value and predict what the equations for R2 and F2 will look like. All right, let's see if you were right. Every time we update our computation, time increases by 1/7. And then you may have thought I was going to write R2 equals 39.66, et cetera, et cetera. But there are two reasons why I didn't do that. One is that I wanted to emphasize that the right-hand sides of this algorithm here are based on the previous values. So I have R1 and F1 on the right-hand sides. R1 is approximately 39.66 and F1 is approximately 8.11. But I wouldn't want to put those approximations in the right-hand side if I had better approximations in my numerical software. So if I do this in a computer, I would like to keep more decimals than just two. Okay, you crunch those numbers and you should get that the rabbits are approximately 39.03 and the foxes are approximately 8.23. And if you do this one more time on paper, the equations look the same. Time has gone up to 3/7 and my subscript's updated, but otherwise it's the same process. And what we find is that after 3 days have gone by, the rabbit population is approximately 38.94 and the fox population approximately 8.34. Again, it doesn't make a ton of sense, but mathematically, let's just work with it. All right, so this process isn't really fun to do with pencil and paper, but you can program a computer to do this for you. I typically use MATLAB. Let me just show you the results. So first, here's a plot of the rabbit population and the fox population over time. So we end at 60 weeks. Each of these plots is made out of 420 points, the values that we get from applying Euler's method, and then MATLAB connects them with teeny tiny line segments. So they look like smooth curves, but they're really points and line segments, and they're approximating the behavior of the real solution to the original differential equation with these initial conditions. I want to compare that to a different numerical technique. So ODE45 is also a way to approximate the solution in MATLAB, but it's going to be a little bit better, or a lot better. So while this is also a numerical technique, it's a lot closer to the true solution. We can compare the two. So here, the dotted curves are with ODE45, and the solid curves are what we had with Euler's method. In this picture, you can think of ODE45 as very close to the true solution to this differential equation. So we're essentially comparing Euler's method to the true solution. And what you'll probably notice is that they're very similar at the beginning. So for the first 20-25 weeks, there's very little discrepancy between the two plots. And then we start to see increasing variation. If you were to increase the domain for time, that would become more and more significant. You could then try to counter that if you wanted to by decreasing your step size. So typically with this kind of process where we discretize time, the more finely we discretize it, the better we're going to do. But that in turn increases the number of iterations you have to do, so there's a bit of a trade-off. So here's another comparison between Euler's method and ODE45, which is closer to the true solution. Here I doubled the time domain from 60 weeks to 120 weeks. What I was hoping to show here is that Euler's method does give you an approximation of the behavior. Focusing on the picture on the left, our initial condition is at 40 and 8, so that's the ending point on the right. And then what we observed with our computations, the first four, is that the rabbits started to decrease and the foxes started to increase. So from our initial condition, our curve goes to the left, that's in the direction of decreasing rabbits, and it goes up, that's in the direction of increasing foxes. You can interpret this as saying that there are too many foxes, they're causing the rabbits to die off. But then there aren't enough rabbits for all the foxes, so they start to die off, but then as the foxes die off, the rabbits start to do better, and we get this around and around behavior. The picture on the right is the true behavior of solutions to this differential equation. It's actually a closed orbit. So we started with 40 rabbits and 8 foxes, and we never returned to those values on the left, but we do on the right. So while our approximation with Euler's method gave us a feel for the behavior, we missed some of the dynamics. Our approximation is spiraling outwards, whereas the true solution forms a closed loop. All right, this concludes our look at applying Euler's method to the Lacca-Volterra equations. Thank you for your attention.